The tail end now of the program, where we continue to look at the state of economy right now, focusing on the Kenya National Trading Corporation and how we should streamline it, how also stakeholders need to be involved, that the corporation needs to hear also the stakeholders as far as inputs are concerned, primarily also on the edible oils is what we are discussing, and a raft of other issues as well. There is a dollar distortion that was in the market, and since we had also the interbank rates being streamlined as well, it seems there is a modicum of restoration from that particular angle. And also the wealthy Kenyans, they're taking advantage right now to stash away a lot of dollars in the dollar accounts. So we continue apace with the conversation. Before we took a short break, we had to hear from Bill Okero, especially on the Kenya National Trading Corporation. Do you hold with the view of what Patrick is actually putting on the table, that yes, there's an avenue to try and involve stakeholders and make the KNTC more friendlier, especially to, you know, the businessmen here in the country, instead of them overriding that particular issue of looking at what input we have for the businessmen here and them importing directly? They could bring raw materials, then distribute, or yeah, make sure that you're buying it at an affordable rate.
Yeah, but you see, the whole thing about KNTC today, in today's liberalized economy, you don't even need the KNTC to do what Patrick suggested.
We don't need it.
In petroleum, they didn't need another entity to import on behalf of. It's within the that particular industry, you can create that competitiveness if you want, or get a government to government if you want, import of crude palm oil if you want. But you don't need an institution, which itself is a company like ours, trading and competing with us. Today, KNTC, the last couple of weeks, they're shopping around now, buying even products locally, beans, cooking oil, and what. And then they're going to sell it. Last week, they were told, oh, there's no money. So many of the guys who are now in the process of delivering are stuck. So you don't need it. We don't need the government to be doing that kind of trading. They decided off with something like, if you tell me something like fertilizer, something like crude palm oil, something that the government can get competitively and then give it to. Whatever, but if it is going to be the way it is operating now, where it's given to a briefcase company to import on behalf of and then charge their premium, for example, the cooking oil, they're buying a 20 liter jerrycan. These companies, all of them are in the news, I mean, you've seen them, they're owned by CSEs and others. They buy a jerrycan at $21, CIF Mombasa, then they put their $4 or $5 on each jerrycan and give it to NKNTC. Then KNTC, because it's supposed to subsidize, will sell it at a subsidy, because, and they're not paying duty. It's beautiful. And so what they're going to do is shut down all the other businesses. Now we can't sell because we can't compete with an institution that is not going to pay taxes and that is going to subsidize the price further. But the whole idea was allow the retail to get his $5. That's the whole motive that drove all these things. And we've said, is this really necessary? So I think institutions like those don't have
any... So this is a very nifty way of tax avoidance?
Yeah, and it's not a very good thing to do. And the tax, by the way, that wherever they're given to this entity is illegal. You know, our East African Customs Management Act, it's in black and white. You cannot allow an entity like this one. It doesn't enjoy any tax waiver status, except Parliament. No one can eliminate tax, which is there by law. And it has not gone to Parliament. So the Ndungu is just forced to sign a letter to KRA. I have given a waiver.
So essentially what they're doing is illegal.
Of course, yes. It's illegal. Everybody knows it's illegal. And Kenya Law Society have gone to court on that matter. And So coming back to, I think, this whole issue of... but I want to comment on this one.
Bido should say Bunyasi, not Derito. But oh, at least they both.
He's a careful man, the way he chooses. And each time he says
Derito,
he really means
Derito. I want to just latch on
that.
Where do we rope in the competition authority of this?
Because this is the unfair previous competition. Regime, I was an independent governor. One of two elected in Kenya, not on any political party.
You should have said it. Except that you're always on top of the car somewhere. When government is doing something, the institutions are emasculated. They cannot carry out their mandates. For example, Kenya Bureau of Standards, The quality of this cooking oil, for instance, that we produce here, there are parameters that are provided by law of what we should produce. But what is being allowed into the country? Oh, KNT is installed, KEBS is installed. No, no, no. This is government. You clear it. And so they'll clear anything that is being supplied in this country. And the same thing with those competitions. They cannot really, when it is government, it's institutions that are being told, my friend, so I think that I don't expect those institutions to act now.
Then we'll be actually getting elements of mercury afterwards. Yeah. Because they've not really gone. Yeah.
As we cross, you remember where we started?
Yes.
This morning's conversation with the health of political parties and the health of opposition. Birokelo remembers around the 10th parliament when Kibaki's second term, and the ability, appointments would be regularly challenged, for example. Have you followed the law? Have you brought in a person with integrity and so on? Because the political space and the environment to offer critique was working. Now, the reason the number one agenda of Kenya Kwanza was to try the best they could to destabilize the opposition is to remove the possibility of a strong voice saying this is wrong, this is incorrect, and offering an alternative view. And it goes back to destroying parliamentary political parties. The two big ones were the target, Jubilee and UDM. In fact, UDM was the first to bolt, yet they were in fact in a coalition, in the Azimio coalition. And then the attack on Jubilee. But it is a particular design, because once you destroy, decimate the opposition, then you are able, you know, because you're asking the question, what they're doing is illegal, how come these institutions, from KEBS to parliament, are unable to that's the whole point of
the competition.
And that's why Jubilee is being destroyed.
You know,
I like the way.
One second. Let me just clarify. Yes. When we were in opposition in 2003 in Kano, and NAC came to power, the same thing Kibaki's government did. They took over, especially all the MPs from Mount Kenya. Majority of them joined the PNU of Kibaki in NAC. But the few of us who remained, you remember, so we stuck to our roles and we held that government of NAC to account. You can. The few of the members of this opposition who are still out there in parliament, who have not been swallowed by Kenya Kwanza, they can carry out their mandate. The issue is what exactly he said. For example, if you have got an alternative, have you brought that alternative to the House? Have you debated that policy? If the inflation, you know, or strategy or policy is wrong, bring it to the House and debate it. Kenyans will see it and they'll hear it. That's what we used to do. That's when we had the official opposition or the shadow finance minister. We used to challenge everything that government did. Holding them to account. We even had alternative budgets. I used to submit every year. But I think the institutions that remained, they are not active. And today they are properly financed. You have minority leader in both houses are very strong. They're well financed, well resourced. Budget office is a very independent institution. They're one of the economic budget, parliamentary budget office. Oh, it's very good and it's very independent, and they can give these guys a lot of backup. So it's just that they have opted for the streets. But inside the House, they have the opportunity to also hold the government really to account.
Yeah, so, and the issue, of course, of Eden Kanan that you are really rallying with, making him larger than life, is he so key that actually all this conversation really ground to a halt because Eden Kanan is on the other side? Now there's another transition of KUJ. But what I was saying is, you know, I like the way Governor Nderitu has a very effective way of bringing in the conversation of politics amidst the economy, just the way Dr. Shem Ochodo knows how to bring the diaspora aspect on every element of our discussion as well. I like it. He has to find a way.
Economic managing the Kenyan economy is the job of politics. I mean, that's what politics is about. The state of government affairs, the state of government finances, for example, has a direct and immediate impact in the health of the
public. I was just saying this with Batang family in cheek, of course.
Okay.
I want just to rope in Bill Okero on this. First of all, because you've been on the dollar issue, and right now I was just reading and scrolling through the dailies. We had on 26th, I think this was yesterday, dollar market distortion eases after Ruto directive. As it eased, we've seen also wealthy Kenyans were stashing away a lot of these dollars in their dollar accounts as it is. What is the reality on the ground? Because sometimes what you read here on the dailies and what you experience when you come is diametrically different.
The one thing is true. The situation of dollar availability has eased after the government's directive on the interbank market. Because the interbank market gives the banks opportunity to enhance their liquidity between themselves. So I think that interbank market should not have been shut down by Njoroge a couple of years ago. It should not have really, because it was helping the situation. So now it has eased, availability is there, but it has not addressed the issue of the rate still. The demand is still high. Mm. Our exports are low, and so today. Up to yesterday, we were still buying at 138 shillings from the banks, big banks like Equity, still selling at 138. The lowest you would have got yesterday was 137.50. Number two, the issue of this money being stashed by the way the media keeps saying wealthy Kenyans. This is wrong headline. Really, it's misleading.
Is it wrong headline?
The money is not by wealthy Kenyans, but exporters.
Exporters.
Yeah. I mean, don't want to convert their money into shillings. Because of that spread still. Because when you are, the government has not yet addressed one thing, which is very important. Mm. But from the interbank, the other main issue is that the government has maintained a parallel exchange rate system. What they are calling the official CBK rate, which they want the banks to use when they are buying. A bank cannot buy at more than the 130, which the central bank has set today as the official rate. So the spread between 130 and 137 is what is making the exporters keep their money in their account. Because if you sell it to the bank at 130, tomorrow you need dollars, you'll be forced to buy at 137. So why should I sell my dollars? I keep it in dollar. This is the money that is in the dollar account. Mm. So and the government is doing this because of the public debt. We've explained this many times. Mm. Yet you know the public debt, external 40 billion that they have to pay for every shilling value. It goes times 40 billion. So they don't want to let go of that. But unless they remove that control by central bank and remove that purported fixed rate that a bank can buy at, then we'll still have this spread between the buying rate and the selling rate, which will keep this money in the banks for a long time. And this is why you see that 1 trillion still lying. Nobody wants to sell its dollars. Why should I sell my dollars? Because if I'm buying it, I'll buy it at 10 shillings more. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Wow. So we're talking about, because I remember you talking about the dollar at 125. Was it 124 in December?
Yeah.
Now we are looking at 138, and it is still counting.
Oh yes, it had gone to 145. Remember?
145 at some point.
At some 145. Point
it reached 145.
Yeah.
A couple of months ago, then it came down.
It came down.
But even now, it doesn't look good because when all this dollar, there are two stories in the media today. The Western overseas foreign traders. Mm-hmm. Pulling out from the bond market, because they have political instability,
30% plunge,
and of course the better performance on the US and other markets. That plus the fact that our euro bond and other dollar denominated loans are falling due, and they have to be paid in dollars. That means the demand for dollar is going to be much higher than expected, and that is likely to push again the prices of dollar up.
Prices of dollar, and now this will trickle down to fuel prices as well.
And cost of living, everything.
The cost of living,
everything.
Fuel prices, I think the one thing that is not clear to me is what is the cost of that fuel at the end of the day. Because if you go for credit for 6 months, who's going to pay for that credit? Right? And that payment for that credit is going to appear somewhere as a cost to me as a consumer. Now that is not clear. Well, I think everybody's talking about the dollar, and trying to stabilize the dollar.
Yeah.
But the price of fuel is going to get
hit
seriously because the cost of that fuel is actually what is financing the issue of the dollars.
Hmm.
Indirectly. Or even not indirectly, directly.
Directly.
Yeah? Because of the delay in payment, somebody's going to, you know, all they're doing is somebody is actually giving you credit for 6 months. And the cost of credit globally is not that cheap.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when you're seeing the economics of Kenya working the way they are. I'm not going to give you cheap credit. Although you are taking it almost like it's a sovereign debt. Mm. Good, as it
were. Actually, there's no transparency on that. We want to know at what rate the government is getting this credit.
So there is a whole issue around this fuel. Whilst we are saving on dollars, yes, and saying fine, 35% of the dollar
required. But are we saving?
Is whatever?
Are we saving? We are kicking the
can down the road.
And only for 6 months.
For 6 months.
Yeah, and the supply of the crude oil
of fuel.
of the fuel itself right now, not just internationally, it has stabilized.
The price of fuel, it's going to go up.
It's going up. Yeah.
It's going up.
Saudi, everywhere, they've all shut
their OPEC is reducing the production.
Yeah. And it's also, as we're going into this month, the summer is coming up. So the demand is going to increase. Go up the other way. So what you'll find is that obviously commodity prices for fuel are going to go up. In fact, from the beginning of May.
So the unga that we have a respite right now, as Jubilee was there, Kenya Kwanza is telling us it's at 130. That is just momentarily, very temporal as it is. Unga is bound to go up. We should brace ourselves. No wonder now we're being warned for the next 2 years.
You can see why.
We're being prepped.
You can see why. Yeah.
You should also confront the fact that what's happening with the dollar has very little to do with what we can do internally here. A lot to do with the new posture in the US policy on interest rates. And that's a very critical thing. And the determinants of how that might change will come out of the equilibrium between the US and China. You know, how they level off their trade relations and so on. It's going to be less. The whole of the continent of Africa is going to be a very small component of that discussion and negotiation. But what happens with the planners is that you have to incorporate that in the plan. Mm-hmm. And in some way, I was going to say, tell Governor Gretu, in some way, that's where you find that in anticipating, in projecting what this might look like, what the market might look like, for example, around inflation, you know, it could be much higher. So you're saying, let us target no more than 7.5%, not because the zero option is off the table.
Mm-hmm.
So I think there are, and then of course you have quick solutions. This fuel one is one of those quick solutions. Eh? I think the biggest risk in this is the fact that this differential, the foreign exchange risk, foreign exchange not just risk, cost that is going to occur will be
borne by Kenya. That's what the minister said.
Yes, in some way related to the power pricing structure, and so on. But it does answer to one of the desires around the table, as had been stated by Governor Diritu, that you can't wait for 2 years. When you're hungry, so do something now that's immediate. They are doing something now that's going to take care of the crisis.
Doing something now is not the issue. The issue is doing something now, but make things cheaper. This government thing on government to government petroleum is not going to make the petroleum cheaper.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
That's number one.
Number two is not going to make also dollars more accessible, more available. Mm-hmm. It's not going to. Because the bank still has to mop up dollars in order to prepare to pay that money when the time comes.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not going to. This thing,
prudent
dollars
bank
that are not available for mopping because there's these guys keeping their dollars somewhere else.
Exactly. Putting them in the market. And a prudent bank is not going to wait to buy on the spot market on
buy
that
today.
Day.
Mm.
They're going
start
to build
now.
But to go back to Wajima's question, that there is little we can do. No, it's not quite like that. Take one example. The East African Monetary Union.
Mm-hmm.
This protocol has been on the table for over 12 years now. As a matter of fact, the target, I think, was last year,
mm-hmm.
by which time it should have been effective.
Mm-hmm.
The collectively, if you look at the East African countries, we probably spend between $10 and $12 billion settling bills amongst one another.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now, so if we were in government, we would be pursuing our partners in EAC to say, let's make the monetary union effective because it saves everybody in the union, mm-hmm. and eases the. Now you can say, what is required? Frankly, it's a head of state's kind of summit to sign off, because the convergence that was required on what we are doing with monetary policy, what we are doing, I don't know with what, basically all of those things are achieved. So it is not, I mean, government has options, not these kind of sort of fly-by-night schemes that are only adding to cost. Because as we've all admitted on this table, the cost of the credit for 6 months will be borne ultimately by the consumer, and the likely forex increase will be borne by the consumer. Back to this question of the inflation target, the reason that thing, it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, because businesses, in looking forward to what level of price they expect, that is what they inbuild. Why do they inbuild it? Because it is law. The central bank is obligated legally to manipulate money supply in order to achieve that target. And it forces the central bank to keep a high level of interest rates. Now, if you reverse it, you create conditions that are useful for everybody, for yourself as government in terms of lower debt service cost, for the production side. And without the production side, without proper growth of credit to the private sector, you cannot expect increases in taxes. So you're asking again, going back to this question of why can't Parliament do something about it? Well, I guess the Parliament can change the Central Bank Act, perhaps to force the CS Treasury to act in a better manner. But the law already is set up so that the CS Treasury, meaning government, is making a policy choice. What this government has consistently refused to do is to make a correct policy choice that assists Kenyans, that brings hope back to Kenyans, and that sets Kenya for a better economic recovery.
But I think we can't let this go. I think let me just throw in something. If you artificially decide that my inflation target is, for example, going to be zero, and the prevailing market conditions, everything taken together, is actually, let's say, 7.5 or 8, you are effectively going to create multiple markets around things like exchange rate. Exchange rate is the value of your, is the trading value, exchange value of your currency versus the other currencies. And if you have set that artificially, you'll end up with the kind of thing that we're talking about. You'll have one exchange rate ruling at one rate and another at another rate, creating what they call arbitrage, creating a lot of movement between the two, multiple markets within the system. And this has happened in the countries where the foreign exchange is getting very severe, for example. So the 7.5 is not, you're not choosing that I'm going to rise up 7.5%. You are aiming at 7.5 when you realize that the inflation rates would be passed in the neighborhood of 10. And you're aiming to target something lower than that. I do not think that the 7.5% now, was an increase from what it would have been, therefore leading to the perverse actions of the type that the governor has described. If anything, the fear was that, and I don't know how much the higher side was going to be, so the 7.5 was that we shall ensure it doesn't rise above that. You don't have the option of nearer 0 or nearer 2 or 3% or something like that under the prevailing circumstances. And now you see the pressure that we have got.
Actually, you do. You see, Kenya is not facing global challenges alone. Every country is facing the same. But the thing is this, look at Seychelles, which is a far smaller economy. Inflation is 2.5% in Seychelles right now. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Look at Eritrea, a far smaller economy. Look at Benin in West Africa, a tiny economy. Mm-hmm. Look at Cape Verde.
All these are economies smaller size than Kenya, mm-hmm. who are doing what I'm explaining, and they are achieving far lower inflation rates. And they, as a result of, you know, because you have to look at the interplay of...
But will those nations be a better comparison?
Let me finish. No, if you can look per capita. As a matter of fact, look at comparator countries, countries with smaller economies than ours, countries with the same size economies than ours, and countries with slightly higher economies than ours. And what you will find is that every country that has chosen a near zero inflation target has, as a result, been able to maintain a low level of interest rates, the result of which, even when they are, and the inflation target is not what Mwenyezi is saying, is not the what is actual, it is the target. But the reason that target is important is because by law, central bank is obligated to manipulate interest rates to achieve the target.
So,
what really stops
the Monetary Policy Committee of the central bank to dial back on these interest rates to near zero, maybe even down to 5%?
Because the price stability target that is signed to them by the CS Treasury.
That's what I'm saying.
So it is held ransom by the CS Treasury.
You know, this is not Europe or America. Our inflation rate is not based on only the interest. Is not about only the inflation. Is not about the interest only. Our inflation, if you look at the basket of commodities that central bank uses, it really one of the major inputs for that inflation is the cost of food. And in the drought, because everything was expensive, the cost of food was high, so the inflation rate was going up. Now with these rains, we expect this thing to go down a bit. That's one. Two. Part of the reason why our cost of living is high also is one of them is government policies, really, not just on interest rates. For example, the government is not the one that is claiming, but it's the fact that the interest rates now are being pushed up by the government because of the borrowing. Today, government is borrowing the bonds they were asking for 14, isn't it?
Yes.
14%. Treasury bills now at almost the same amount. So when the government is in the market borrowing at that, which bank is going to lend
to him,
10% or 13%, they're not going to give it to the government. And all other policies, including taxation and all those things on food and on imports that are making things very expensive. This is why our neighbors, small countries like ours, and they're importing things from here, and they're affected by the high cost of raw materials from outside the country, the same way we are affected. But their exchange rate has stabilized. It's not like ours. They have not gotten to a worse situation. Tanzania, Uganda's currencies are much better than we are, you know, and it's because of all those factors. So I think quite a bit of what we're seeing here is all about government, really, and the way they play their cards. I don't say that if Nderitu was back, he would do those things right, because he's saying so
he'll
now.
He'll be under state capture. He'll be staying home in central bank. Yeah. We'd ask you, the applications are still on for the central governor.
Since Bill Okello seems to think I've been in power all this time, he should at least acknowledge that when we were in power in Kibaki time, things worked.
I really wanted to go back to that time, because that was the time when we had the highest GDP growth this country has ever seen.
Indeed.
And the elements that went in at that time were the different elements, inflation, the basket that goes into inflation, all the elements were under control one way or another. And as a result of that, it allowed us to grow as a country drastically.
And they were listening.
Right?
They were listening.
They were listening
to
them.
And
to the technocrats.
They were listening to
Kemsa. If you remember at that time, things were being tackled one by one. One of the first things that was tackled was just a simple thing like roads. That's where this whole roads program started. Mm-hmm. That you just move around the country to be able to move your produce around. So the discussion about let's just fix the roads. And where did it start? Industrial area, mm-hmm. which is where the production was happening. Mm-hmm. So you just fix the roads in industrial area and you'll see what will happen. Mm-hmm. Because you're spending so much time going to work, so much time taking produce out, trucks are getting stuck and everything else. So the idea of listening and just doing one small thing after another led to a whole series of measures, not at one go, but over a period of time, that actually led the economy to start, the GDP to grow at, you know, it accelerated over time. Yeah? And by the time it was coming to the election of 2007, it was, yeah, I think, about, what is about 8%. Almost 8%. Right? To drop down to zero the following year. Yeah? And it has never recovered to that level again. And I think the issue of how you manage the macros in the economy have all got to be looked at with a view to driving the economy to grow, to drive internal generation of money in this country. Mm-hmm. Right? And when you're looking at external factors and trying to get them to do things in this country, it might just not work for us.
They,
as we're seeing at this point in time. Well, so I think the listening has to happen, but the whole management of the various triggers that grow this economy have got to be managed very carefully. Mm-hmm.
The relationship in terms of these interest rates and the cost of food, remember that agriculture itself is borrowing at this high, in incredibly high interest rates. And the, should I say, subsidized credit to agriculture is a tiny amount of money, 500 million per year, that the agricultural finance is able to disburse. Otherwise, agriculture is in fact getting, if you're a smallholder farmer, you are probably borrowing from your commercial bank at 18-20%. You know, so we it really does go back to the spiral effect of the inflation target.
Thank you.
And once you bring it down, you can manage the rest of the variables.
Right. I got like 20 minutes on the clock right now. Yeah. Very interesting that we have, you're talking about being in bondage, CBK, but we see the Treasury himself, the Treasury CS.
Who is this?
Ndungu.
Oh, he's the one chained to the whole thing.
The one who's chained to the Euro bondage.
My goodness.
Of the huge padlock there, Euro bondage, the nation is stuck on the external debt treadmill and is firmly in the grip of what is widely known as Euro bondage. The debt situation is piling pressure on government finances in an unprecedented way. Will Kenya free itself from the chain of greedy and expensive European lenders? That is a probing question that was asked. And I just wanted to, you know, maybe dovetail this particular discussion with the diaspora bond that the deputy president was seeking from Botswana, when he, not really Botswanans, but of course globally. Yeah, so we can speak about it. And I'll be remiss if we don't really talk about the housing levy briefly before
Shaka
we.
Shakahola
as well?
Shakahola. No, we don't want to talk about Shakahola.
But the fact that the media has been bad. We could interrogate why the media is bad regarding that. But let's lean from what the president had to say and also the deputy regarding the diaspora bonds and the house levy.
Tuko na housing fund ambayo tunataka kila Mkenya a contribute pesa kidogo. 3% of your income, 3% of your salary. Kama unapata shilingi 10,000, 3% ni shilingi 300 kila mwezi, uweke katika hiyo hazina. Pale mbele, utakuwa, tutakusaidia vile utanunua nyumba. Kila mfanyikazi ambaye anaweka 3%, sheria itamulazimisha yule mwajiri wake, pia na yeye aweke 3%. Na sisi, tutaanza kama serikali. All employees of government. Dawa ya kupunguza gharama ya maisha. Kupunguza gharama ya chakula. Ni kwenda shambani. Mbegu. Mbolea. Tulime, tuzalishe chakula. Hiyo ndio mpango. Hii ya sufuria kwa kichwa na maandamano. Haiwezi hata punguza chochote. I promise you. Thank you.
The government wants to create an investment forum guaranteed by government for the people in diaspora. How you can invest back home in a safe manner and your savings are safe. We'll be mapping out credible real estate developers to work with the State Department of Diaspora Affairs that can build homes for people abroad, and the government will guarantee so that your money is safe, so that there is a framework within government that once you get some real estate developers to develop you for you, the government will supervise and ensure that your investment is delivered. We need you to save at home. Other countries where we borrow money, they lend us money from savings from their countrymen. If you people agree with a good framework to save money at home, that is the money the government can borrow for development at an interest instead of going to China. We go to China because there is nowhere else we can borrow money. If we can develop a saving culture for our people in the diaspora, because your money is huge, and that's what I want to appeal to you, when the PS and our team works on that framework, please come in. We have a responsible government, and there is no responsible government that can let anybody lose your savings.
Clearly, the government is seeking every which way to get money, and remittances from the diaspora has been a big one, and right now is the diaspora bonds. Let's just chime in, first of all, on the house levy, because I think we have limited time. We can't really plumb deeper into it, and also now the diaspora bond. I think it's Bilo. It's Unitan. Let's just pick up with you.
The housing bond, the housing now.
Housing levy and diaspora.
No, bond. No, I don't support these levies. When I remember the former president Kenyatta also tried to introduce it, and we did not support it, because, look, you cannot burden Kenyans with all these levies. Mm. You are raising the NSSF, you are raising NHIF, you are raising house levy again. Look, there's a limit. You have got taxes. You have got so many other things on people's income. I think housing is a private sector matter. Provide the appropriate business environment for private sector to invest in housing, and they will do that. No, you don't need. You will not need to tell anyone to invest. All over the world, people will come and start building houses in Mandera and Nairobi and Kisumu and everywhere. And there are many ways government can do that, and they have done it in many other countries by addressing, particularly providing incentives around investment into housing, making cost of construction a bit more competitive, and more importantly, providing other ways in which you can benefit from the investment in terms of your taxes and so forth. That is the way to go, or go to the simple way you have done in the previous regimes, in the public-private partnerships. But I think this collecting money, I don't think levying Kenyans every time on everything that you want to do, levies, is not the right way to go, in my view, and I don't think it's the best way. The second thing is on the issue of the euro bond. For the government, it doesn't matter about whether you borrow from your own citizens or you borrow from other citizens of other countries. You know, it's still the same. It's you're borrowing. China and Japan are the world's largest credit nations. The peasants in China who are farming out there, the guys who are the lenders, through the bonds into the U.S. government. So it doesn't really matter whom we get the money from, whether it is our Kenyans working in the U.S. or in Botswana, but at the end of the day is that the government wants to borrow, and they're looking for every trick they can find to raise money.
Maybe, Eurobond is not available. The Kenyans, they'll give a better moratorium.
No, I mean, why would I lend to government at a loan when I can buy? No, I don't think so. In fact, our diaspora people expect better. They expect to get better terms,
from
a premium from us, from our government. because you want them to bring their money to Kenya, so you should be giving them more. So I think it's a good idea to try and work on the issue of diaspora trying to channel their resources into the country, not just through bonds, but I think through many other ways that we have discussed on this table many times. But the key thing is government, and you know there's a trust deficit in this country about giving government things, but borrowing is not a big deal. It's government guarantees, government loans are sovereign loans, and I have no problem.
They were approaching the issue of Sukuk bond. Sukuk bonds, when you're coming to Islamic, of course, banking as well, interest rate is more, there's no interest. But I know there are other mechanisms on how also they can actually gain. Is that an option that we can actually look forward to? We go for the Sukuk bond?
I think they looked at it and they want to review that again. From what I hear, they want to get back again to the same, because they're looking at every possible way in which they can, Sukuk
bond. Maybe they had forgotten about Sukuk bond.
Yeah.
They can't forget. Right now, they're looking everywhere. I'm surprised I've not really talked about Sukuk bond. Look, talking about listening, the housing levy is not the first time that we've been talking about the housing levy. And we suspect the reason also the PS Hinga is still left there is because of his house levy. The administration knew maybe we'll latch back into it. But there was protestations against it even from the beginning. Right now we have the public servants who are really protesting. The teachers have said they will not really buy the housing levy, as it were. Is the government listening? Did the government listen then?
Houses should be addressed through SACOs and other things. I mean, really,
it's not really the business of government.
Are you talking to me now?
Okay. I was looking. Anyone of you actually can speak.
Then I'll come in.
I just want
the government doesn't want to speak now.
I just want to put a small thing on the table.
Yes.
There is somebody investing in student housing, big in this town.
Yeah.
Kwetu.
Yeah. And a student, how much is a student earning? And this person is able to make a whole business out of housing students. Somebody who actually, a lot of the affordable housing are for people who are working and probably earning more. So why should you be levying when you can actually create the right environment for somebody to put affordable housing in this country? That is the question that I have.
Mm.
Point two, there are already a lot of statutory levies that we're paying. NSSF is a big one. And if you remember NSSF in the old days, when people were extracting money from NSSF, it was through housing and trying to create housing. If you close those loopholes, and I believe they're now closed, they're not, Drummond, whatever it is, those companies that were benefiting from NSSF and taking money out and then going under. Yeah? NSSF now
Drummond can build or something,
a big pot of money. If you look at one of the biggest people investing in South Africa, it's the pension scheme in South Africa. That's the one that is investing. And they're even putting money into Kenya. The pension fund in South Africa has got people who have been given that pension money to come and invest in Kenya to get a return. So the one unit that everybody in the world uses is pension funds.
Mm-hmm.
To create a port for investment. You do not need all these other levies.
And it's huge in this right? country, our pension fund.
And if you look at NSSF and then you put all the private sector pension funds together,
it's huge.
That's a big amount of money. But you've got to have the right trusted framework to extract that money out and begin to use it into this economy. And I believe that is what we should focus on, is to create that framework, a trusted framework that can extract that money out and begin to use it to develop this country. Whether it is housing, whether it is whatever it is, the money that is sitting in the pension funds, which we are pushing into a pot that is limited. When you look at the Retirement Benefits Act and all the various buckets that people
can go
into.
You should mention the amount.
Yeah.
Our pension fund is almost about $15 billion now.
$15 billion.
Dollars.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's huge.
So where the restrictions are, where they can put and all the rest of it, exactly. We need to be creative
and
in that area.
And circles, also and trillions, circles, we haven't put hundreds
that,
of trillions.
All those things, yeah. If you put all that money together,
the money is there.
There is a lot of money that can be used to invest and
then
bring this
country. Unclaimed assets as well.
Yeah. And in, and not only in housing, but you're talking about the health services, water, and everything else. If the framework is right and there is trust in that framework, this country does not need to borrow from anybody. It needs to just tap into
thank
the
you.
Money that is sitting in this country.
We need to wind up. I can see the sun is upon us. So we are standing up here.
Personally, I have no difficulty. I know there are issues around taxing today rather than tomorrow. Even if it's savings, forcing the savings now for consumers today, they would say, I would rather use the money now than be forced to save because I'll use it in old age. There are those questions. And if the economy is not well managed and the currency completely collapses like the Zimbabwean did, then those savings in the future will be worth quite little. But if it's well managed, that's what most countries are doing. Take countries like the U.S. Mm-hmm. The U.S., other than pension funds, which are very significant, and they are not only in government, they are also in the private sector, the 401k funds, they are all manner of ways in which those that money is saved. And people are living longer in Kenya than before. So we're going to get into a situation in which we need that money ever more than we did as a generation and the future generation. I think the challenge is that when people are pushed on the wall, anything you do, even if it's good for them, anything you do, you say, don't spend this on consumption today, you'll do so tomorrow. And the person is saying, but then I will not have dinner. If you're down, if you're pushed that much, then anything, even if it seems good in the aggregate, is painful individually. But it's not an unusual thing. And in fact, pension funds are used a lot in construction of infrastructure, housing included, and so on. So,
thank you.
I think that is something that we
yeah.
could do.
Yeah, and the reason.
Yeah, with our closing statements as well. So,
okay. The reason the levy is a poor idea, in the aggregate, is actually a very poor idea. First of all, as you yourself agree, a better policy is to support pension funds in other long term. Financial flows like that to support investment in housing which are long term. So Kenyans are right to say, look, that's a bit too much and there are too many levies. What government ought to be doing is removing the roadblocks that make it harder for the provision of low-cost housing. On the euro bondage question and whether, you know, as Cook bond or a diaspora bond and so on, look, you call it what you want. The basic issue is that government is leaving beyond its means. We the budget deficit is big and keeps growing bigger. This government that came on board on the promise of doing something different is actually increasing the budget deficit. You will notice in the budget policy statement, their intention is to have a budget of 6.7 nearly trillion, not six, 3.6 trillion. Now, if you're having difficulties financing what you found on the table, which was around 3.2,
yeah, it had been
3.6. No, it hasn't. How do you expect to finance the additional 400-500 billion? That is what the problem is. Also, the economy runs on confidence. You must find a way to rebuild the investor confidence, business confidence, consumer confidence.
Thank you.
And not by telling us you're postponing the problem by 2 years.
Right. I think we need to wind up on that without even getting your closing remarks, because I think the sun is smarting your eyes, I can see.
Yeah.
And it's warming up the samosa as
yeah.
well.
Yeah.
That's what you want. But thank you very much, gentlemen, for that. I think it's been a very massive discussion on this, and just given you the pulse of where the economy is right now in the country. We want to thank you, Engineer Patrick Obath, for coming through, the chair of KEPSA Foundation, also the chair of Vision 2030. Thank you for coming through. This is Munyasi Isakwa. We want to thank you as well, Bill Okero, who is an economist and businessman.
He doesn't want to call himself a politician anymore.
Former
politician.
Leader.
Once a politician, always a politician, say. And Dritumuridhi, immediate former governor of Laikipia and economist as well. We thank you so much for coming through. Asante sana. Don't go away. News Diary. As a spokesperson. Next time, you want the president. Usieke sufuria kwa. All right, thank you very much for your valid company.